How's my voice down the back? All good? Fantastic. Like I said, I'm the muscle nerd. Not been close to the bike at all, but I know how to make bodies perform really, really well. And you're just an extension of your bike. So ideally, over the next 20 minutes, I want to give you guys some of the basics, some science behind making your body perform at its absolute top level for as long as possible. And it'll get really sciencey. Then I'm going to give you the common sense behind the science. So hope you enjoy it. But if you've got your little book, let's open up to the overview and I'll talk a little bit about what we're going to go through today.
And the other thing for any parents or anyone, don't be scared to ask questions.
Yeah.
Get the information you want.
Yeah, so I'll present most of this and then we'll get to the end. And if you have any questions, definitely use the time that I have here to pick my brain. Before we go into it, look, I want to get to know you guys a little bit more. I don't know how open you guys is. Is happy to stand up and tell me a bit about your goals? Because you're all here for a reason, aren't you? You want to become a bit better. Does anyone want to share what your goals are? I know there's an Australian champion here. Yeah, a couple of Australian champions?
No, I'm joking. Not me, I'm
not. probably try and make it to Aussies this year.
Yeah. Cool. Anyone else got their eye on that pot, Bryce?
Just get people scared.
Cool. Alright, so in today's presentation I'm going to talk about increasing performance. And that's it. I deal with body transformations, so the bulk of my work is getting people to lose weight, but this is the stuff I really love. It's the stuff I eat up, because you practice this day in, day out, you're motivated, and I love getting people, getting athletes to perform better. So we'll talk and touch on some immediate strategies. They're the most popular strategies. They're probably the ones where the big money comes into things, with energy drinks. You know, you drink an energy drink and you smash out a race. So I'll give you the science on energy drinks, science on sports nutrition and performance enhancing supplements, and then we're going to talk about some long term strategies as well, the boring stuff, but the stuff that counts the most. So if we flip over and I'll talk about the payoff now. So anything you do in the 14 days leading up to the race will only have a minimal impact on the race itself. Right? Similar to skills, you've got to practice a lot with your skills to get really good. Same thing goes with and what you put into your stomach. Anything you do in that 14-day period will probably only account to about 33% of your total performance on the day or on the weekend or however long your event is. Everything you do in the 84 days to 365 days and more counts for that 66%. So when you're talking about becoming an athlete, well, you're all athletes, becoming a higher-level athlete, especially a professional athlete, it's things that you do day in, day out. It's the habits that really count. So, what do you think is the biggest impact on performance in the short term?
Fitness,
yeah. What else? Any other suggestions? Don't be afraid. Yell out. All friends here. Food, what you eat. Yeah. Okay. What happens on a hot day? Sweat. Yeah. So your hydration levels actually account for about 60% of your performance. So on a really hot day especially, hydration is number one. The next thing is obviously what you eat. So the fuel in your body, just like the fuel in your tank, the more fuel you have in your body, the better you're going to perform. Sharper you'll be in making decisions, the quicker your reaction times will be, and the more you'll have in your tank when it comes to doing some explosive trick on the bike or something like that. So, on the topic of hydration, when we're looking at hydration levels, we're looking at how much water we're holding in the body, and the easiest way to determine how much water you have and how much water you lose is just jumping on the scales. Has anyone ever jumped on the scales before a race or a ride and then jumped on after? No? You have? Yeah. And you notice the weight loss? Yeah. You know how much? No. Well, that's all right. I don't expect you to. But that there is your single most effective strategy to knowing how much water you need to drink before, during, and after a race. Because that weight loss is really important. That weight loss is your loss of water. And your performance significantly drops when you've lost 2% of your body weight. Who knows what they weigh here? Any idea?
26.
26? Yeah. On the notes there, you'll see a 70-kilo rider. They lose 1.4 kilos in a ride. Their performance will significantly drop. So towards the end of that race, they're not going to be making decisions really quickly. Their reaction time will go down. They'll be more susceptible to crashing into another bike, crashing into a tree, getting the turn wrong. All of that stuff starts to unfold. So that's for a 70 kilo rider. I'm looking at the crowd here, and your average weight will probably be about a kilo, half my size or less. So that's even more dangerous when it comes to a hydration loss, because for somebody who's lighter, you only need to lose 500 grams, 600 grams of weight, and you're getting to that danger zone. 4% loss actually results in illness, exhaustion, stroke, and sometimes even death. Okay, so it's pretty heavy stuff. 4% loss. I wouldn't doubt that all of you here probably suffered heat exhaustion at some point, okay? And that's probably due to a severe loss of water. So today, what I'd like to really get across is this stuff matters, this water stuff really matters. Sweat rates, they vary anywhere from half a litre, so you can sweat out half a litre of water, to 2 litres of water every hour. What's the average time of a race? You can tell me.
First,
is there an average race?
It's 7 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes,
yep.
30 minutes.
Yep. And do you do back-to-back races in a day, or is it just one, you go there for the one race?
No, they might have multiple.
Yep, so average multiple amount.
Some could do 6 races in a day.
Yep.
Six.
So 6 times 7, you're getting close to that hour, and then you've got about a 2 litre loss there. That's a 2 kilo loss, and that's severe hydration loss for someone who's around the 50 kilo mark. Thirst is not a reliable cue for drinking. So that's a really important point. So moving on, getting away from that heavy stuff, let's talk about some hydration strategies. Who's got their form there, or their little, can you read out for me? What's your name, right? Hayley. Hayley, could you read that first one up out for me? Way before and after training. How many times a week would you train?
Two or three.
Yeah. How many races do you have a year? Depends.
A few.
Yeah. So comparatively, you have a lot of chances, don't you, of you training to get this water stuff right. Every time you train, you should be treating it like a race. Every time, if you want to be a really good athlete, if you want to have the edge over the guy who wins, you need to be a really good athlete. And really good athletes, they have habits that they perform every single time they get on the bike, or every single time that they get on the court, whatever the sport is. And it starts with weighing yourself before and after to gauge approximate water loss. But if you know how hard you sweat, you know how much you lose, and you can drink and make sure you replenish and perform at the top. So another thing is, you're probably all sitting there and thinking, water's boring. I find it hard to drink water, it makes me sick. It's actually, it's something you train your body to do. Your body will get better at hydrating itself and using the water that you bring in. Conversely, if you don't drink much water, it's gonna have a hard time hydrating itself, and you will have that sick belly kind of feeling. So drinking water is something you need to train yourself to do. I can do 12 litres a day on a really hot day in Dubbo. So, and I'm only training for about half an hour in the sport that I train in. So you guys are sweating harder than me. You probably need to work on getting in at least that amount of water. But what can you do before a race or during a race to is on simple strategies, 200 mils of water or sports drink every 5 to 15 minutes. What do we sort of drink when we're racing? Who can give me some suggestions on what they drink? Do they drink?
Water,
yeah, Maximus is like Gatorade, isn't it? Yeah. How much water would you normally drink? So pretty good amount of water. And you're having the Maximus, how much would you have of that?
Probably a bottle, like a
litre. Yeah, cool. So good hydration habits already there. Replacing that weight loss by 1.5 times is important as well. So the 2 points from this slide that I want you to take on is 200 mils of water or sports drink every 5 to 15 minutes, depending on how hot the day is. You can use these strategies over the next couple of days. Sunday's going to be about 41, so
you've only got a half day Sunday.
You've got a half day, yep. So make sure you use these strategies, and then weighing yourself before and after, and then replacing. If you lost a kilo, then you need to drink a liter and a half of water. If you lost 2 kilos, it's 3 liters of water. Okay, moving on. So hydration is number one. Next thing is carbohydrate. That's our fuel. That's pretty much the fuel that you put in your tank. You put carbohydrates in your body, it does the same thing. Carbohydrate availability, when that goes down, your performance will go down as well. So if hydration is the 60%, carbohydrates is the 40%. Stored glycogen. So carbohydrates are stored in your muscles. The more muscle you have, the more stores you'll have. Okay. It doesn't mean you need to become a beefcake like me, because that'll slow your bike down. But you need to have a lot more muscle than fat on your body if you want to be a really good athlete. Muscles use about 1 gram of carbohydrates per minute. So if your race is 7 minutes, how many grams of carbs have you used in that race? You know how much fuel to put in your bike to race for 7 minutes, so you need to know how much fuel to put in your body to race for 7 minutes. 7 grams. Alright, so 7 grams of carbohydrates, that's for intense exercise. So getting on that bike, throwing around that bike, probably weighs more than you, that's intense exercise. Hunger is not a reliable cue to eat. In fact, the harder you ride, the harder you perform, the less hungry you'll be. Okay, so your body sort of shuts down and goes the opposite way. You need, it doesn't want to perform as high as you're making it, so you need to force it to, therefore use these strategies that I'm giving you. So refueling is essential for maintaining multiple bouts of intense exercise. If you're going on a race weekend and you're doing 7 events in a day and then you're doing another 7 events the next day, whatever it may be, refueling at each point throughout the races is really important. So, looking over now to the carbohydrate loading strategies. A small amount of carbohydrate and protein, 30 to 60 minutes prior to intense exercise, increases your carbohydrate availability. So, that's like fueling up your tank, going to the BP, putting it in. We need fast absorbing carbohydrate. So who has an idea of what that might be? Something that's quickly, easily available. You've got something in your hand there. An ice block. Yep, sugar in that, sweet. Hey, yep, perfect. So anything with glucose, sucrose, maltodextrin, lollies are good. But you'll need to drink a lot of water with that, with those lollies. The dose is around about a gram per minute of exercise. So if you go over that, you will spill over, you will sick, you'll feel sick, and you won't perform as well. So depending on how seriously you want to take this sport, getting those strategies in place during your training will improve your performance and make you better and better as you move up through the ranks. Small amount of carbohydrates and the protein. So a good example of a race day would be about 60 minutes or half an hour before that race, having a drink that you can get some glucose powder and some protein powder, and you put it in a drink and you can drink that. You could have a small tin of tuna and then something else on the side that's going to give you that sugar. There's some ideas, but there's a wealth of ideas. You can use fruit like bananas, oranges. You just need to eat a bit more of those because there's a little less sugar in that sort of stuff. But there's some practical things you can use to improve your performance. Finally, before we move on, this part's really important. The Maximus drink, Gatorade, Powerade, they've all done this for you. They put their carbohydrates in that drink in a 6-8% solution. So that ratio of liquid to carbohydrate is optimal. So drinking those drinks are really good to be through. In fact, you should probably have one drink to two waters. You can flush out some vital minerals and vitamins from your body if you drink too much water. So having 600 mils of your Powerade, then 1.5 litres of your water, and keeping that ratio is about where you want to be looking at.
Should you vary that for their weight? Because that might be good for a 50, 70 kilo, but you've got 22, 25 kilos, 26, 10, 11 year old kids.
Yeah.
Should you do like 300 mil and 100 mil?
Yeah, it comes down to common sense at the end of the day. That's what I'll go through at the end. You can't go and whack a 25 kilo, 50, 30 kilo kid onto something like this. And even if you are 70 kilos and you've done none of this before, this is optimal, this is up here, but doing the little bits and the little steps in between is crucial to be able to stomach that and train yourself up to that. So I'll go through that sort of stuff towards the end, but that's a great point. Now we've looked at the loading, let's look at the refueling. Because the way muscle works is it squeezes out all this energy. So you put something in your body, you use it, you need to refuel it before the next bout of exercise. Depending on how long you've got in between races, about 1 gram to 1.5 grams of carbohydrates per kilo of body weight. So that's where we're getting into that ratio there. In the first 30 minutes and every 2 hours after, for at least 4 to 6 hours, is optimal for replacing those fuel stores or giving that fuel that you need in the tank. Again, fast absorbing is great or best for post-exercise, but slow absorbing is the best in the hours after intense exercise. So, for example, you just finished a big day of riding, go home, have a big bowl of pasta with some meat, or a couple of slices of bread with your sandwich meat, or whatever you might decide to have. That's going to give you the fuel for the next day, or the training session that you do throughout the week, or the weekend later, however, whatever your structure is. Cool, flipping over, energy drinks. Who's your favourite pro rider? Who are they sponsored by? Yeah, we've got Red Bull riders, we've got V riders. Nothing Rockstar yet, there's nothing wrong with energy drinks, but you need to know what the research says, okay? Because they get a lot of screen time, but they may not be the most effective route. Who does have an energy drink for a race or around a race? Doesn't matter if you do, yeah? Cool. I'll tell you what the most effective ingredients are in those energy drinks, and you might be able to find an alternative, or you can keep doing what you're doing. But the research says, despite the array of ingredients, so you know how they got the guarana in there, or they've got taurine and all those funny named ones, the big names and the complex names that gives them the price tag, that doesn't do much. The main ingredients are the carbohydrate, which I've been talking about and banging on about for the last 15 minutes, and caffeine. Caffeine's the biggest one, so that caffeine shot's going to give you that rev up that you need to get you through. A black coffee tends to do the same thing. So if you're already having those energy drinks, coffee is going to be too bad. Consuming a can of these energy drinks can improve your mental focus, alertness, and performance. You've got to understand that energy drinks are pretty new. Okay, they're pretty fresh. Science hasn't really caught up to them. They're saying that it's pretty good, but there are some adverse events and side effects that must be considered. So if you are under 18 and you are having energy drinks, make sure it's under parental supervision, and parents, make sure they're drinking a buttload of water. So for everything that I've said for the last 15 minutes, if they are consuming energy drinks, double that. Yeah, that's how much water that they need to be drinking. If they go to the toilet and they're peeing green or peeing yellow, they need more water. So make sure you monitor that as well. That's a really important thing to monitor, because that'll give you your hydration status. Awesome. You still with me? Yeah? Huh? Like I said, it's all on video and you're getting this as well. All right. So So here comes the common sense part. That was very sciencey. Let's talk about some long-term strategies. So none of this stuff that I've just gone over for the last 15 minutes is going to have a huge impact unless you get this stuff, this next part, right. The three major things that affect your performance over the long term is one, your metabolism. Two, your posture. And three, your strength and conditioning. I'll go through, I'll define all of that now. Metabolism. Who knows what your metabolism is? Nope. Who wants to have a read off that sheet for me? Who's got a sheet? I'll have to bring you again, Hayley. Might have to go. Yeah. Unless you want to give me a read. Matt, shy. Alright. I'll read off it. Your metabolism is a hairy bag you can pursue. So, well, most of you are pretty hairy. You're probably not hairy. You're a bag of chemical soup. You've got a bit of hair, a few hairy bags, Demi. This hairy bag of chemical soup is basically your body is constantly converting food into energy. And if there's no food in your stomach, it'll actually convert what's on your bones, the stuff that sits on your bones, your fat and your muscle, into energy. So if you're not feeding yourself, it will eat itself. That super reaction determines three things, and it's how you look, how you feel, and how you function. And those three things will ultimately, basically, affect how you perform in the long run. So optimizing your metabolism is really important, and here's how we do that. So there's four main things that affect our metabolism. The first thing is body temperature regulation. So on a really hot day, your body's working hard to cool itself down. On a really cold day, it'll work hard to warm itself up. Now, after this weekend, I don't want to see any of you running outside under the sun naked trying to affect your metabolism, because the effect is really minimal. Alright? So no running around in the snow if you live over in the Alps, because that won't work either. We'll look at some heavier stuff that has a bigger effect on it right now. The two things that have a pretty similar effect on metabolism is nutrition and exercise. So that's around 12 to 17%. So the things that you do every day, like the riding that you do out here, that will affect your metabolism, right? And then what you eat as well. And finally, in the long run, the thing that has the most effect is your muscle mass. So how much muscle you carry on those bones will optimize your metabolism, because that's the only thing that burns carbohydrates, stores carbohydrates. It's your fuel tank. So the more muscle you have, the more of a fuel tank, or the bigger the fuel tank will be. Healthy adults, this probably relate more to the parents, but kids, as you grow older, you're gonna become adults. Healthy adults lose muscle mass at a rate of about 2.5 kilos per decade. So this rate of muscle loss underlies a lot of the things that we just put down to getting old, so sore joints, back pain, that sort of stuff, all the way up until obesity, diabetes, and all of the heavy stuff that we hear every single day. So muscle is really important. Athletes are predisposed to losing muscle mass faster. The next thing is posture. Does anyone know who Darren Roberts is? He's a trainer, he's actually a muscle nerd like me, but he trains some of the Red Bull riders like the Watson brothers over in the UK. Here's a quote from one of his articles. I did a bit of research before I came here, so I came on. Motorbike riders tend to be very anterior dominant. So anterior means the front. So you'll have tight shoulders, tight chest. And because of that, what you'll find is the back muscles get quite weak. And when you do fall off the bike and you fall and sort of try and brace yourself, you'll be susceptible to ACL injuries. Fall off the bike, you will be susceptible for dislocation of the shoulder as well, because everything's forward and the back stuff. So improving the posture drastically reduces those injuries. And here's how we reduce that risk. Improve the posture by relaxing tight areas. Does anyone ever have sore muscles, tight muscles after a race? thing just pull tighter than the other, what happens? Then it goes this way. Right? So you can relax that string as much as you want, but unless this string is as tight as the other string, nothing's going to work. So you need to strengthen those weaker areas. And for you guys, it's the quads, the glutes, the back muscles, to eventually create what's called neutral posture. I'm actually opening my gym doors for you tomorrow, so we'll go through a couple of exercises tomorrow. You'll get hands on with me and we'll show you some cool exercises to fix that. And you're probably wondering, where am I going to fit all this in? And you probably only need around 10 minute, 15 minute strength sessions a week to really optimize this stuff. Maybe even one. Moving on, strength and conditioning. No matter what sport you do, whether it's motocross or tennis, badminton, table tennis, stronger athletes are better athletes. Okay, it's a blanket recommendation. Stronger athletes have a lower risk of injury. They have less downtime. What does less downtime mean?
Watching TV and being lazy.
That's downtime. Less downtime means
more ride time.
More ride time.
Oh wait, did you say downtime?
Yeah, less downtime. Oh. Okay, if you've got a broken leg, well, that's all you can do, sit down and watch TV. But less downtime means more practice time. So that means you can learn more skills, become better, upskill, so forth. Stronger athletes don't work as hard as their weaker counterparts. So they always have more fuel left in the tank. And I've got a little demonstration to explain. If you've got your slides in front of you, you'll be able to see this. If not, you'll see it later. But let's, for example, say that we have got two riders, and these two riders have been practicing for the exact same time under the same coach. They've got the same skill level, but one of these riders can deadlift from the floor 100 kilos, and the other bike rider can deadlift 50 kilos. So one's twice the strength of the other. The stronger athlete will have a maximum output of about 1,000 newton meters. That's how we measure how high you can jump. So if you're jumping, you're trying to flip your bike, and you're trying to get that explosive force through your body, that's the measurement that we use. So that stronger athlete has more power than the weaker athlete, which means that, you know, when you're going through the race and you're just kicking some flips and you're just doing some sort of mediocre tricks, that's called race pace, right? And to maintain that race pace, that stronger athlete doesn't have to work as hard. So when it comes to hitting the big triple, you know, he's gonna have a lot more power and a lot more fuel left in the tank to land that trick. Now, I probably sound a bit stupid using these terms. They're probably not exactly right, but you get the idea. So, what I'll finish on is how strength and conditioning can help your performance in the long run. This only applies to you if you want to get better every single year. If you don't want to get better every single year, then this probably won't apply to you. You can just keep doing what you're doing now. But if you want to get better every single year, this is my recommendation, and this is how I think you should train. Obviously, there are times throughout the year where you're doing a lot of riding, and there are other times throughout the year when you're not doing as much. So you would structure your year based on that. In the times where you've got your off-season, where you're not riding as much, you might still race competitively during that off-season, but you don't really care about what your performance is like. You use those times to work on the things that aren't directly impacting your performance. So, for example, you would not do as many skill sessions and you get into the gym, because that's an indirect effect. So you work on that base stuff, that foundation, and that's where you'd be working on your strength and power and your posture and all those little things that you forget about. Because in Australia, what we've got is a bit of a problem in amateur sport. We think training harder, doing more exercise and doing the same thing over and over again will make us better. But over in America, where sports is huge, they've got it a little bit better. They've got it more down pat. They understand that the other things that you do, the stuff on the side, affects your performance. So at the start of the year, you probably work on your strength and your power, and you do that for 12 weeks. You get a result from it, you measure it, then you go into your next phase, which is a power and endurance, okay? And it's not until you go from strength, so you fix your posture, you get some more strength, then you go to endurance. So running and getting all your fitness levels up doesn't matter unless you're actually going through those phases, because you'll always hit a ceiling if all you do is endurance. And what you do on the track is endurance. So you have to get off the bike sometimes. So you work on your power and endurance after you've worked on your strength and your posture, and then you go to your skills around that championship time. Around that time where you really want to perform at your optimal, that's where you drop the gym and you smash the track, okay? So in layman's terms, championships are over, what do? Smash the gym, you leave the track to the track for a while, then you get back on the track once you smash the gym. And it's just a rotating cycle from there, okay? So that's it. That's all I've got to talk to you about. I know it's a lot.